Good afternoon or good morning. This is Russell Hendrickson with PDS. Thank you for joining us today. Today's webinar topic is Building Successful Healthcare Dashboard Visualizations. We've broken it down into 10 proven steps. Joining me today is Michelle Perry, who is PDS's Director of Web Analytics.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining today's webinar.
Today's topic is how do we take something like this and turn it into something that's highly visual, it's interactive, and users literally can look at data and point and click and drag and drop and make changes to that data in seconds. So if I just want to look, for example, at all of the physicians that have high third next available appointments, I can quickly just highlight them and then start to look across at which physicians have very high utilization, over 100%, which probably means we're forcing their schedules. Or we can look down and try to understand why is this physician have such a high third next, yet they're only 50% utilized. And we can quickly start to see if we want to look at just who has appointment lags greater than 30 days, what types of visits we're seeing the longest wait times. The idea behind visualization and what users are looking for is not only can I just point and click, but I can interact with the data, I can change the data, and if I want to, I can drill down. And I might drill down to lower level elements that are built into my dashboard, or I might even want to be able to drill all the way down to detail.
Users are not only looking for this interactive visualizations, but we're getting more and more requests. For example, with scheduling data, a user wants to use a quick map visualization where they can filter on a particular state and then maybe zoom into an area where they can quickly see where their patients are populated to understand what they need to do to meet the business needs within that particular area. And that brings us to the goals of today's topic. So for the next 50 minutes or so, we're going to discuss the understanding of visual dashboards, and we're going to learn some proven steps and approach to building these visual dashboards and creating visual interactive dashboards from scratch. And lastly, we'll discuss and understand some common mistakes to avoid and pitfalls which can impede the success by explaining some of our experiences that we've dealt within the organization.
Excellent. So let's start first with what is visualization? And visualization is really the idea, you know, that a picture is worth a thousand words. And so the term visualization, you hear it and you see it all over right now, you know, virtually every software application, every software tool, every, you know, analytics vendor is talking about visualization tools. You know, I even heard of a bank, a local bank, television commercial, you know, it was bank you can trust, proven, you know, for many years, and visualization. And I literally said, what? You know, they're marketing a bank on having visualization tools, but that's how commonplace this term has become, you know, in the last 2 years, certainly. So it's the idea of understanding data visually and then being able to tell a story so users can just interact with pictures and visuals rather than having to work through numbers or KPIs or metrics. Breaking that down a little further, we like to add interactive data visualization because, you know, building dashboards, graphical dashboards has certainly been around for a number of years. It's not a new topic, and I'd be willing to bet as we talk and we're going to survey, run a little poll here on this webinar, that you already have visualizations and you've been building dashboards for years. So to me, at PDS, when people say visualization, we really mean interactive visualization, dashboards that you can interact with, slice and dice through. Users without a whole lot of training can drill down into the metrics, understand visually what the story is being told, and even slice and dice and drill all the way down to the detail to understand what's going on within the tools. What we see here at PDS, as much as there are every major analytics vendor, and if you look at, you know, reports from Gartner Group and Forrester, you know, some of the organizations that actually survey analytics vendors for market success and usage across businesses, you know, there's quite a variety of vendors. But here at PDS, because we only work with healthcare organizations and health systems, what we see most prevalent, and these are listed in alphabetical order on purpose, is people using IBM and the Cognos layer. Organizations certainly working with Microsoft, but beyond Excel, you know, Microsoft Power BI has gained a lot of acceptance in the market. Certainly MicroStrategy is one of the major independent vendors that we see popular in healthcare, Click, SAP Business Objects, and of course Tableau right now has a lot of buzz in the marketplace as well.
Great. And with that, we'd like to take our first survey. So in a minute here on your screen will come the poll. And we'd like to understand what percentage of your current dashboards are prominently visual. Great. So it looks like we're pretty much distributed right around. You've got most folks being somewhere between 0 and 50%, and then we've got about 40% being that 50% or more. So pretty much what we would have expected based on today's state of visualization.
Excellent. So, you know, and this really begs back to my suspicion is, you know, if you look at, if I can see the results here, what about, 60%, like you said, Michelle?
Yeah.
What it really ties back to is, you know, users are asking for more. My suspicion is the reason why you're attending today's webinar is this is something that being asked of you or your organization, or if you're a business user or administrator, you're looking for more visualization and how do you take advantage of this technology to best manage your organization. We are certainly seeing that very heavily at PDS. This is probably the number one business requirement or need that is being discussed with us as we talk with healthcare organizations. And so one of the challenges that we're going to speak to today is how do we address these short-term needs? You know, we need visualization. We want to be able to use this technology. We don't want to wait. But how do we then fit that in with longer-term strategy, which are sort of more traditional analytics business intelligence questions, like how do we manage data governance? How do we standardize? You know, do we really want every single user building their own visualizations and not ensuring that we're following metrics that run across the organization and are, you know, to the standards that we've been trying to manage to? And ultimately, even how do we, you know, train users to both build, use, and then support these tools?
Great. And with that, we have just one more survey that we'd like to take. And have you seen an increase in requests for visual dashboards? So pretty much what we would expected, which is why everyone is on the call today. So we've got 60% where the high, you're getting most of your requests. They want visualization as the top priority, with the next being about 30%, you're getting more and more requests. And that really relates to what we're seeing as well. So we are getting more and more requests to be able to provide those visual dashboards. And as we have more of those requests, we really need to understand how are we going to satisfy those requests? What strategy are we going to use to make ourselves successful? So some of the questions you may want to start thinking about to get a successful strategy is, where are we today? Maybe you have a few dashboards available that you're going to make visual. Maybe your requests are more and more. And then where do you want to go? Do you have a plan? Do you have somewhere to start? And then what are the key dashboards? What are the key initiatives? And do you have a plan for that? Do you have some steps that you're going to follow? Are you going to do it a phased-in approach? What are those phases? Do you have something that you're going to pilot, or are you just going to try to build it? Probably want to come up with a pilot. And then understand, based on all of those needs, you might have to really evaluate your staffing needs. Do you need more technical staff? Do you need some more budget for additional skills that people are training that folks are going to have to take? Or maybe you don't have the skills within your organization, so maybe you need to go to other areas outside of your organization to fill those resources, whether it be to skills or whether it be somebody actually building those dashboards. And Russ has a common expression that we hear within PDS quite often is sort of take that walk, run, a fly approach. Don't try to do everything immediately.
Yeah, definitely. I can't stress that enough. You know, certainly if you read the healthcare journals, if you read and you look at what's going on in technology, you know, visualization is the number one sort of priority for CIOs, certainly organizations, and you know, it's how do we use this technology that big companies are already using to drive results. And what we've done here, you know, over the years of helping organizations build dashboards, bring together metrics, and really drive business value through analytics, what we've done is break down a strategy that we're going to share with you now, which is the 10 steps that we've found are useful when trying to build out visualizations, especially if you haven't done anything like this before. This is a great, you know, place to start. The first two steps, as we talk about them here, is really in what we call planning or strategy. And so it's the idea that step one is really what business need or what challenge are we trying to solve? It's great to say we want more visual dashboards. And it's great to say we're going to use visualization to improve our organization. But if we don't start breaking those down into very measurable goals, really, okay, but let's be specific. We want to improve patient satisfaction. We want to, you know, make sure that we have the best patient access. We want to ensure that we're managing our chronic care conditions and our patients better than the average is. Or we want to improve performance, or we want to be a leader, you know, even if it's in a particular area. We need to start to define how we're going to use visualization to improve the business and what are we trying to accomplish and how will we know when we're successful. So it really is worth breaking those down. Even if you have an enterprise level analytics goal, breaking that down into where are we going to start? How are we going to measure success? What is the business need? What does the end result look like? And start to identify and define our goals. That's really step one. Step two then is, what metrics do we need to support those goals? Do we have the data? Do we need to find the data? Do we have raw data, but it's not modeled? It doesn't answer the questions. And, you know, but what is it that we need? So this is really the business perspective or the business need that needs to be defined and understand what do business users need in these visualizations before we even begin to figure out how to make them come to life.
Great. So after we have a plan and we understand what that business need is, the next four steps I like to talk as the data phase. So we need to identify what data is necessary, as well as where is that data going to come from. We need to consider, is it available? Is it not available? And then also, while we're identifying that data source, we also need to understand the refresh rate. If I'm looking to populate a metric on a monthly basis, but it's only available every quarter, I may need to reevaluate what I've planned out in the previous steps. And then step number four, understanding your data and understanding if any data transformations are going to be required. And there's really two types of data transformations. I like it is one is metric transformation. Do I need to take two metrics and do a percentage or an average? And then the most important transformation is really that relationship transformation. And how does the different data that we're pulling together to answer the business need, how do they relate? And do they align? Is there a correlation? Can I get them to correlate? And you may need to do some data transformation in order to get them to correlate. So once you've identified the data and understand where it's coming from, the next step is to really put that into practice. And the step number five is really a very manual, small data modeling. And we like to do that just simply by entering 10 or 15 rows into an Excel spreadsheet to verify that the metrics and the structure is going to work. Okay? Once you have that, on step number five, you're going to move on to step number six, where, again, I'm not going to fully model everything. I'm going to manually model it, but this time I'm going to pull maybe a month's worth of data or maybe a division's worth of actual production data and make sure that it works correctly and that I can verify my transformations and that all the data is going to relate together. Again, I'm going to do this on a small data set, and I'm going to do it manually before I get into really creating a full model.
Excellent. And so, Michelle, you know, from an IT perspective and from a data warehousing perspective, the steps that you're recommending here seem, you know, almost foreign to me, especially if I'm used to pulling together data in a database and I'm used to, you know, working to join rows of data and I'm starting to build, you know, schemas and models that are going to relate all that data. And you're talking about pulling data into rows of Excel. It seems a little, it seems like the opposite of where you might want to start. Don't I need to grab all the data and pull all the data together and start to stage all that data? And the real reason is so we can get to step seven and eight. So we're going to save those heavy data warehousing lifting steps for steps 9 and 10. And let's talk about why those steps 4, 5, and 6 are so important, those data steps to where we're headed. Once we pulled that data together, as Michelle mentioned, and we might just be working with a subset, we might be working with, you know, 10 physicians in one department for 1 month, a very limited set of data. But if we know we have the right relationships in the data, now we can start to pilot out dashboards. And again, we're recommending using something like Excel. Now, if you don't want to do it in Excel, do it on paper. Do it with a pen and a blank sheet of paper. If you want to sketch it out on a whiteboard, that will work as well. But the key here is to start to frame out what we can publish, knowing what we have in the data. And we're going to present that to the business users to validate that we've got the right data, we understand the relationships of the data, and the data that we pulled support the business case. And we're going to kind of repeat that step until we feel like we've got something that addresses the business need. It's not necessarily the visualization need, but it addresses the business need. At that point, when we feel like this is solid, even if it's not fully mature, we've got metrics, they correlate. If we had this data, we could start managing or publishing. Now we're going to move into our visualization software. And this is the fun step. This is the step that gets people really excited, because now you're actually able to bring to life that data that you modeled that Michelle just discussed in steps 5 and 6. You can very quickly bring to life in a pilot, oftentimes within hours or a day. And then you're going to repeat and tune that process. Now, again, you're not trying to publish your final visualizations, but the goal is you can start to present to the business users and validate that the data you've pulled and the legwork that's going to be needed to support this drives back to where we started in steps 1 and 2, which is the business need.
Once we've done our planning, we have our data, and as Russ talked about, that pilot phase, that really looking and working with the tool, validating that it meets the user's needs, we can then move to steps 9 and 10. And this is what we like to refer to as sort of as the production phase. So, and these steps may be interchanged. You may do 9 before 10 or 10 before 9, or they may be iterative. But step 9 being the production implementation. So take that Excel modeling that you did, that very manually modeling, and really design it out with your ETL. Do a full data modeling where you can do automation as well as maybe automating how you're going to gather your data. And then taking that and deploying it enterprise-wide, so being able to deploy all of these visual data dashboards that have been created.
And this is really where that heavy lifting step comes in that I was referring to. This is where now you might want to start looking at the relationships to the data from a database side, from a schema side. And this is where you're going to go back and take what's been built manually. But because you have a map, you have a model of the data under the structure, as well as you have a map of what you're going to visualize to, it's very easy now to engage IT or engage somebody who may not understand the business case. But certainly when you can show them the end result, much easier to data model. And this is the same approach we use here at PDS time and time again, because it's much easier to show the modeler what the result is and the relationships between the data. When you've built out a map, it's a guide, and it's very easy for them to say, now that I see what you want and I know what we have from data, now they can build and do those heavy lifting steps. But let's break down this example a little further into a case study, and we're going to walk you through it. Now, there's just a couple things. I know everybody always asks. We will be sending the handouts as soon as the webinar is over. The 10 steps are in the presentation that you just saw we covered, so certainly you'll have them. We're not going to repeat the 10 steps on the screen, but we're certainly going to talk to them as we walk through the case study here. But you will have those handouts of what we're going to show here. So, what we've done is let's work with a case study, and let's start with a fairly easy example, which is we want to visualize physician productivity data. So let's assume we've defined out some, you know, easy goals, right, which is we want to improve performance. We want to understand where the gaps are, you know, from where we could be, where the, you know, physicians could be producing, where benchmarks are. And we want to ensure, as part of improving performance, that we also have patient satisfaction and quality, because obviously fast performance or high performance with poor quality is going to drive loss of patients, unsatisfied patients, and it's going to drive down our reimbursement. So it's, you know, the two go hand in hand. In addition, we want to then understand and illustrate, both at the department level and at the provider level, what's the impact or what are the drivers that are drive productivity. Okay, and we want to make it easy so we can quickly see which are the top performers and we can understand how they're performing, to use that to best understand where the poor performers are, what's going on with their KPIs, and better help us drive why do we have productivity issues if we have them, okay? And then, you know, another goal we laid out for this project would be to show physicians dashboards and visualizations so they can self-correct, so they can quickly see, understand the story, and get the feedback they need to improve their performance. How do we go about doing that? How do we start that process?
Right, so I would start with that planning phase, and really more probably maybe referred to as a brainstorming session, is identify your readers, identify the audience, and understand who that audience is. Who are the content experts? Maybe content where the data is, or how does the data relate? And really understanding and making what is the expectation? What are the time frames for this expectation? Maybe you need to think of a short-term goal and a long-term goal. And then what type of dashboard are you trying to produce? How often will the dashboards be utilized? How are they going to get distributed? So these are all some of the questions that you're going to want to ask yourself during that planning and brainstorming sessions. To make sure that you're going to get the results that are expected. And really understanding the complexity of the results or and what skills that you may need in order to move forward.
Excellent. You know, and I had, I have to relate, you know, just a little less than a year ago, I had the opportunity to go down and work with the CEO of a large health system where we did this brainstorming session and really how it came about, and this was a perfect setting for it. You know, we talk about trying to set goals and then even define what are the metrics, what are we trying to accomplish. And we did the brainstorming session in the boardroom, and the room that they picked to use had whiteboards on three sides of the room. And the CEO stood up and he said, this is what I need. These are the metrics I need to be able to see. These are the users who need to be able to see them. I need metrics for the Board of Governors. I need metrics for the department administrators. And at some point, we're going to drive that down to physicians, but I need to start with leadership and management. And he literally wrote all around the room, these are all the things that I'd like to have. These are all the different KPIs. These are all the different areas that relate to what I need to see. And it was a very powerful session because by the time we were done with this brainstorming, it wasn't, here's what the end result will be. And there were challenges, and we'll talk about what to do when you can't get to the data. But what it did allow for is, you know, we had all the ideas of who and what and when and where and why and how, which is really what you're trying to do. And from there then, as he left the room, as they're typical to do, and there was now, how are we going to build this, we had all of the different stakeholders in the room, which included IT, people that involved in the current data warehouse initiative, people that were experts in patient satisfaction data and other areas. And so it really then the work begins to, okay, now that we have a set of goals, we have some goals, how do we go about achieving the goals and how do we break those goals down into what can we work with first and what is going to be challenging? So again, thinking in phases in that walk, run, fly. And so what I would like to say from the brainstorming is, let's start to identify what are the easy goals, what data do we have to work with? And most of you are probably already doing this. I mean, physician productivity is not a new topic. Most organizations are doing something like this where you're looking at physicians' RVUs, you're comparing them to each other, and you're comparing them to benchmarks. Just about every single large health system is working with some benchmark data where they can start to define and understand which physicians are performing above or at least the median of a benchmark, and which physicians are well below, you know, the stated benchmark. And this, you know, sample dashboard here, you can quickly see where the physicians with the poorest performance are. But what this dashboard doesn't do, although it tells us we have a gap, what it doesn't do, which we want to accomplish with our visualization, is it doesn't tell us what are the supporting factors as to why these physicians aren't performing. And so that's really what we're trying to accomplish with our visualization. So let's go back to what we were talking about. If we want to manage physician productivity against the goals, the next step to break this down is to think about our data. What do we have currently? Well, actually, we haven't even gotten to data. It's to think about what are the drivers. And most of you, and I sort of skipped right through that, but let me stop and go back to our process. Most organizations are already measuring these things. We know the drivers of productivity. Are we coding accurately? Are we undercoding? Right? Patient volume. If a physician doesn't have enough patients in their schedule, they're certainly not going to have, you know, RVUs at the level that we want to see. Are they turning in their charges late? And of course, we want to bring in patient satisfaction, even if we're not joining that to productivity. That's a key driver, right? So the place to start with when you start to break down goals is, what are we doing today? What data do we have? What reports do we have? You know, and how, what can we use that we know correlates? And again, this is an easy example where we're going to build on this through the presentation. Many organizations we talk to are already budgeting. Physicians measured against budgets for RVUs. They're bringing in quality indicators, or, you know, instead of just looking into volume of patients, they're already looking at utilization or third necks available. You know, even looking at the length of service for a physician is an interesting metric we've seen organizations use, because, it, you know, a newer physician who's building a panel of patients is not going to have the same productivity as a physician who's been with the organization for 10 years. So these are the kind of thing that you need to look at what you currently have, what data is currently being measured or monitored, and that might be your initial place to start while you're planning to do the harder data sets as we get into those. The other thing that we need to talk about, and this could be its own webinar topic, certainly here at PDS we've talked to this several times, but we have to bring in order to make a visualization, we have to bring in benchmarks or targets. We have to be able to tell the story. And without digging too deep into this, if we don't have current benchmarks in place, you know, most organizations, again, they have RVUs, they have benchmarks, they can compare specialty physician back to regional or national benchmarks. So that one's easy. But what if we don't have benchmarks for billing lag or patient volume? Well, there's two easy ways to create benchmarks. And again, this walk, run, fly. Don't try to do something you've never done. Start with what you've done and then build on it to get to the higher levels of, you know, analytics and visualization. So, you know, some of the easy things is to either build targets based on the average, you know, the bottom half and the top half, and then you or use internal benchmarks. How is every physician in this department doing? Let's measure the average or the median, and then we can stratify the population and use that as an internal benchmark. So it's critical when we think about our data that we then start to think about a context. But a very simple way is just to do a bell curve and pick the bottom 20%, the top 20% in the middle if we don't have anything. And you'll see some of that as we talk further.
Great. So now we've done a lot of planning and we know what we want to do. Now we're sort of into that data phase. So steps 3 through 6. So you really want to go through each of the metrics that you've identified and understand what application has that data. Where can I get the data from? Is there already a report that exists? Or maybe there's a database that I can pull that data from. Do I need any special access in order to get to that data? And then, can we capture accurate KPIs? Maybe I need to work with some raw data to create those benchmarks like Russell just talked about. And then, who is the expert of the data? Do we understand it? Do we have the appropriate metrics that can be utilized? So again, I'm reviewing each of my data points and asking all of these questions. And then I need to consider, how are we going to obtain it? Again, is it quarterly data and I'm trying to measure it monthly, or vice versa? So I need to understand what the refresh is and how am I going to get that data. And then think about how the data is going to relate and how am I going to correlate the data with each other. Maybe I need another data source in order to correlate two other metrics. Okay. Now I'm going to take that data as we described and I'm going to do some simple modeling. And I'm going to look at creating a small model with some very limited production data and start creating a simple model that I can use to work with to present to my users to make sure that I'm meeting their needs. So Russ, if you can show that first dashboard based on this, what we started with when we actually created this initial dashboard. Great, so this is a simple model that we started with, an Excel spreadsheet where we put in some sample data and we did some visualizations. But as we started to work with it, we realized it really wasn't quite answering the business need and really wasn't communicating well.
So if you think about step 7 in our process, where we've now modeled, you know, taken the model data that Michelle mentioned, the test data, we've now brought it in and we've framed out a rough dashboard. And these steps may overlap a little bit. They're not strict, you know, don't go to step 7 while you're still working on step 6. But what we found in actually doing this process was this dashboard did not communicate effectively. Now, it wasn't meant to be a finished product, but what we found was the reds were too bright. The focus was too much on there's too much red here instead of what was really going on with the data. So through that revision within Excel, we moved into something that looked a little more like this. It's the same data. If you look, it's even the same data points in the example here that we're showing. But what we did was we softened the red, yellow, green. We put in the flags and the indicators, and there's much more emphasis now, if you look, that this physician for work RVUs is performing below the 25th percentile. Right, so it's a little easier to see, yet at the same time, the color still allows you to look across the time periods to see that this physician's performance really hasn't changed. The six-month average, the last month average, and the current month are really still red. At the same time, if you scroll down the right side, you can see patient satisfaction has dropped, but overall, the charges are coming in quickly. Volume appointments is good, and coding here, so our sample here in our PowerPoint probably isn't a great example because it looks like the physician's doing everything right but keeping their patients happy. But obviously that's not always typically the case. Let's take this a little further then. In addition, when we're modeling our data, if we're going to do any kind of interactive dashboard or department level dashboards, we want to be able to roll that same data up across not only one time period, but multiple time periods and across our departments. And so if we've modeled out one department, let's say, or one specialty, with multiple physicians across one or multiple time periods, we can apply, though, for our internal starting points, the same kind of red, yellow, green. And that allows us then to take it here. Now, once we've done this, the next step is we're ready to start building visualizations. And there's really two reasons for that. One is because we now have data to work with. We've validated the data. We've gotten some initial feedback from users, not on the designs, but is what we're representing accurate? Would this help us to manage? Can we now see where there are potentially our gaps by looking at the data? Now we want to start to tell the story. So from here, we would start to model into data. Now that same department level data that you just saw in the screen I pulled up, here's an active visualization that we built out. We're using the same red, yellow, green, which was our starting point and our goal. This is fully built out so that all of the data points are active. I can click on different time periods. I can filter on different groups. Okay, so everything in my visualization allows me to see. We have included a little data window because we do find as we start to slice and dice through the data, I find it useful to see. If I want to see all the physicians that aren't hitting their charge lag goals, I can just highlight them. Very quickly, you can see, well, we have a problem with geriatric. Now, that's because we have a lot of physicians doing nursing home rounds, and so therefore they're not getting in their charges. Yet at the same time, by clicking on that filter, we can see there are some physicians potentially that are turning in their charges quicker. So maybe we could figure out what they're doing. Okay. In addition, we can see there's also a couple of physicians here. Not only are they not turning in their charges quickly, patient satisfaction is very low. Right? And so at any point, I can just highlight or filter on any of these, and we can start to see where we potentially have issues or where physicians aren't hitting whatever the goals are on the screen.
Right. Russ, so can you reset that back? Because I not only like to look at the low performers, but I like to look at those high performers to understand what are they doing well that maybe we can replicate to the low performers, as well as look for opportunities for improvement. So you can see we've got those high work RVU volume, but their coding percentages, I still have a few doctors that can improve that coding percentages, as well as some doctors which can improve their charge lag. And then I've got most of my patient satisfactions are okay, but there's definitely not, they're not all green, so there is definitely room for improvement there.
And that really goes back to, we don't just want to generate heat on poor performers, we want to shed light on best practice, who's doing well, and use them to model and ideally drive best practice within the organization. Taking the same data then, we can also build out a physician visualization. Now this one is fairly simple, but it was designed to mimic what we laid out. All right, so what you can see on the screen here is, again, we've not presented, here's their work RVUs, and that's red, yellow, green we followed. Obviously, these could be softened. We've got our charge lag, our coding percentages, our patient sat, okay, and we've run across months. We can start to change and filter the data. The idea here, typically is you might have security, so when you log in as a particular physician, that data panel is automatically going to change. We've used similar, pin cushions to see green, yellow pinpoints, and red where performance might be down. And we can even build in, to, if we want to, across where are the targets for our goals. We want charges turned in under 4 days, so you'll see that's here versus here versus here. So these dashboards make it very easy to communicate, you know, whether it's red, yellow, green, or to communicate points. What we've really done, and the goal here then, is we built through a visualization. This may not be the end product, okay, because as you know, with visualization tools, I can start to publish dashboards and allow users to interact with them, even change, if you want to give them that functionality, the way they're looking at the metrics by being able to change the charts and the graphs and the displays. So through the visualization, though, we've walked through steps to get to a visualization that you can put in the hands of users and then continue to tune the process. And the tuning might not just be the picture, the displays, or how you want to present that data, but it also might be adding and enhancing data to it. Really kind of two steps, but if you've been to any PDS webinars, or and you probably, everybody who's been in healthcare know dashboards are never finished, visualizations are never finished either. They're going to continue to evolve, and the technology really makes it so you can evolve your dashboards. What's also nice, though, is once this data has been modeled and staged and you go to production, the same data, you could build 4 or 5 different visualizations to serve different business needs or different levels of users, but they're all hitting that same data source. So as you'll see, we've evolved this, though, and it really goes back to, we started with a fairly easy example to illustrate through the 10 steps. But what if we want to take that further now, which is, you know, really trying to drive to more business value or enhance where we're going? And so, you know, the next level of things is, well, we might want to then take productivity and build out a visualization for physician comp. So we want to go further now and build on RVU production, but start to relate, you know, not just patient satisfaction, but patient access satisfaction or quality scores. And we want to be able to relate and bring in even common clinic goals and start to show physicians, here's how you're being paid, and here's some of your incentive, which is now tied to our shared risk contracts. And so your comp plan is, you know, going to move to something like this. We want to visualize it. Or more commonly today, what we're seeing from organizations is they want to be able to do something like this. They might have a very simple, you know, somewhat manually calculated comp plan that's more productivity revenue driven. But they want to be able to show physicians a multitude of metrics visually as to where they're going. Well, these obviously are static examples. We would typically start by building them out in Excel. We'd follow the same steps, right? So if we want to build on what we've done with RVUs and start to join that up, and we want to build on our patient sat, we now would have to start to bring in the other data sources, model that manually, then we could start to model into visualizations. And so, you know, the goal here is we want to be able to take this and really drive it into something that might look like this. Here's a visualization by physician. Okay, so here you can see the same sets of metrics. We can illustrate visually that the physician is missing about 1,000 in their comp. Why? Because they're missing their patient access satisfaction score. So physician dashboards, this one is meant to gear off of and was built around the Excel example. But if we take this data and we go a little further, now we're looking across at all the departments. We're comparing the comp that's been paid out to the comp that's been earned. Here you'll see we built on those RVU tiers, so we can start to quickly see who's not hitting tiers, who's hitting tiers, who's at the top of our comp. We've blended in and we're now visualizing these are our top performing physicians who are earning the most. These are our bottom 4 performing physicians, but as Michelle illustrated earlier, our best performing physicians, we still actually, you can see there's 3 that jump right out that are missing some of their quality metrics and not maximizing their bonus. So even our top performers, we could go back and say, well, look, you can see you're missing on these scores. So visualization makes it very easy to tell the story, visualize, and publish different dashboards.
Great. So that leads us into our next topic, is what if we don't have starting metrics or reports or KPIs to build from? Physician compensation can be fairly complex and is often calculated by hand. However, clinic, quality, and patient risk scores are just a few examples of where you may have no data that you can start with. So Russ, can you walk us through your run-fly approach on how we would do something for patient risk scores where I need to be able to do that modeling?
Yeah, exactly. And Michelle, you really highlight an issue, and this is probably the number one phone call or question that I see when we start engaging with new organizations is they'll come and they'll say, well, we need visual physician compensation dashboards. You know, that's the question. Well, what do you have today? Well, we don't have anything. Well, why not? Well, it's all done by hand. Okay, well, why is it all done by hand? Well, because there's no methodology. We can't really get the data. We don't even have all the metrics. Sometimes we're pulling in, you know, data coming back from the payer, and we don't get that for 3 to 6 months. Well, that's probably not a realistic goal if you can't get the data. But let's talk about data that you can get, or let's, again, use this approach. We also see this a lot with clinical quality data. People saying, well, we need clinical quality dashboards. Well, let me ask a question. Do you have clinical quality analytics? The area that I want to talk to certainly is something that we've helped organizations with, which is, you know, doing patient risk scores, HCC scoring. And so most organizations, when we talk to them and they say, well, we'd like to be able to build out chronic conditions, understand where our high-risk patients are, understand, you know, which insurance plans, if we're not managing these chronic conditions, we're going to lose incentives, which are ultimately going to cost us money, but we're also not providing the quality of care we need. We don't have a way to risk score. We don't know how to get to the KPIs for risk score. Well, let's jump back a second here and use that same approach. The first thing is we don't just want to go try to build out visualizations on risk scored or chronic conditions when we don't even have the ability to measure or calculate or publish what are the risk scores by patient, let alone summarize them across years, do year-to-year comparisons, et cetera. So this same walk, run, fly approach, at some point you're going to have to build out your data to get to the right metrics. If you can't get to the right metrics, you're not going to be able to build a visualization on it. It's probably the number one thing that we see, you know, people will call it, well, I need a visualization. Well, do you have the data? Well, no. Well, let's start with the data points. We always have to go back to breaking down the data. Where does it exist? If you don't have the resources internally, that's where you need to look outside the organization. And certainly here at PDS, we do this all the time. So to use this approach, we want to build out our risk scores. We need to validate that data. We need to be able to run and give the users, here's what's going on, the pieces of the data. Then we want to be able to start to summarize the data. We're going to then start building out reports that help the users solve the business issue. And then we're going to start to build out static dashboards. Of course, along the way, and this is key, we want to validate that data, because building a visualization on data that doesn't validate is not going to be very useful, and oftentimes it's counterproductive because the users aren't going to trust the data. But let's assume now that we've modeled out that data and we're now in this starting to build out samples, static reports, and static dashboards that we can turn into a visualization. Michelle, do you want to talk to this one here at a high level?
Right. So here's a pilot that we did, and where we're simply showing scores and displaying the key metrics and really understanding how we can drive improvement. You know, I've got some, I'm comparing previous years against each other, as well as using some simple indicators. So this may be maybe a first pilot that you will start with.
The key metric I want to stress here, and if you've never looked at this type of a dashboard before, you're not working with this data, the key metric I want to stress is this blue shaded region right here at 80%. And so the reason for this is here we are, we're looking at an individual physician. And these are all the patients that have chronic conditions. And this year, Dr. Allen has our 102 patients, which is down from 2016 where he had 108. But the key here is here we are in September, and Dr. Allen has treated, so we've risk scored 82 of his 102 patients, which means he's 80% to his goal. He's 80.4% to his goal, which is great because we're in September. If this was December, we'd have a big issue, right? So being able to manage how many patients we've seen, but ultimately having this as a starting visualization allows us to take this type of data and then turn it into something that looks like this. Now, this isn't specific to Dr. Allen. This is actually HCCs across the organization. But let's go back to what are we trying to accomplish here. First off, let me just walk you through at a high level. Certainly, we can look in different risk scoring years. We can look at payers and locations. We can even dig down to providers. This dashboard, though, is designed, one, to stratify the patients and start to understand which physicians are seeing the highest chronic care conditions. And so just by filtering on the red, we can start to see where are those conditions and which physicians have the most patients that fall into those multiple conditions. In addition, we've actually projected the revenue associated with those patients if we're not managing those conditions correctly. So this dashboard, very easy to do, but let's go back to that physician example. We're showing the physician has seen 80% of the patients and scored them correctly out of what we know is a population of 102. This dashboard really was designed, these two marks here that say gap and suspect, just by clicking on current year, what it's doing is it's actually measuring how many patients, is there a gap between what we know their conditions have been scored at in the past and what their score should be this year if we've appropriately treated and coded and submitted that correctly. So simply by clicking on this, you can start to see which physicians and how many patients fall into that gap that I just showed on the static dashboard. And of course, we could build this down and publish this out. You can start to see where they are, and we could continue to slice and dice and even drill through the data to get all the way down to who are the patients and where do they sit. So it makes it very easy to interact with visualizations and dashboards, and just another example where we start to build up higher levels of data that we don't have.
And I just want to say all of the visualizations that you've seen today were built out utilizing these steps. We started with a static template or a pilot, and we were able to take that template and bring it to visualizations very quickly and easily because we had a starting point. However, we've seen some common mistakes through this process that we'd just like to bring to your attention. And the first one I call picking the software tool first. And that's not necessarily that you're picking the tool is wrong, but it's really thinking that you can get to step 9 first. Thinking that you can start immediately with building visualizations without either having model data or having a plan or knowing what business need you're trying to meet. Again, those first 4 or 5 steps are very, very important to the process. And then another common mistake that we see is not really identifying your resources. Do you have the correct resources, whether it be content resources or IT resources? And are you allowing enough time to train not only on the tool, but to train to understand the data and how to utilize those dashboards that you've created?
If I were to summarize here, it's really going back to thinking that we can visualize something when we don't have data to work with. We haven't done the homework to get to the KPIs, to get to the reporting, to get to the metrics, but somehow we're magically going to jump to visualizations. We can't visualize data. We can't measure. And if we can't measure it or break it down or have it, KPIs, I always say, if you can't put it in a spreadsheet, you're probably not going to be able to visualize it. Because I can put it in a spreadsheet, I can load it right in and start visualizing. Visualization is actually easy. Staging your data, relating your data, and understanding how to correlate your data, which really becomes more the business. What are we trying to communicate? What are we trying to accomplish? That's the hard part of visualizations. The tools are actually very easy.
And some of the success factors is, again, I keep talking, have a plan, have a goal, is really having clear goals and planning. What are you delivering? Who are you delivering it to? And following the process that allows you to achieve success. So we talked about the 10 proven steps. Russ talked about that some of them may be done at the same time, but you want to make sure that you don't skip any of the major steps because that you're just going to have more problems. And then also coming up with a realistic time frame. As I mentioned earlier, maybe having a short-term and some long-term goals, making the time frames realistic so you can be successful in delivering something to that already relied to. And then accurate assessment of your skills and resources. Are you truly, do you have the resources and do they have the skills that you need? Don't make any assumptions there. And then probably the most important one is leveraging proven designs and templates. If you have a static dashboard that's working, then you probably are able to get the data and you can model it so that you can do your visualizations. So work with proven design templates or results that you already have.
And certainly the last one, and this goes back to your strategy, what are we trying to accomplish? Is there an ROI? Are we trying to build visualizations for the sake of having sort of the latest and greatest software? Are we actually trying to improve our business? We've defined measurable goals, and we've broken down those goals into achievable steps, really, is, in my mind, the difference between being successful and just, you know, driving technology for technology's sake. Michelle mentioned this, but when we engage with customers, we do have a library of starter templates. Most of the Excel examples you've seen in this, actually all the Excel samples you've seen in this presentation have come out of our library. And so when we work with clients, we have over 100 different templates in the library that are active today. Over the years, we've had several hundred that have been come and gone. As we continue to improve and drive best practice for reporting and visualizing data, we also have software tools that are designed to simplify doing those pilot phases and getting results quickly and results that can be put into production before you even brought in your enterprise or analytics or visualization tools, and we have many customers using those. We as a company also have experience modeling data. If we can get our hands on the data, we can model it and stage it to help you build visualizations. We certainly have proven methodologies. And I can't stress this one enough either. It's having ongoing training workshops, supporting our customers so that as you build and work through these dashboards and visualizations and your whole analytics BI strategy, that as your organization evolves, you need to have a company to be able to stand behind it. One of the ways we do that for our customers is we actually have workshops where they're interactive. They're similar to what we're doing here in the webinar, but they're interactive with the trainer or the consultant or the expert, who can then share and answer questions as we go. And for those on this call that are PDS customers, we have one of those coming up October 12th. You should have just seen the latest schedule. They're also available on our website under training. And certainly here at PDS, everybody who works from a visualization or analytics tool forward is trained on our methodologies and has experience helping organizations be successful, not only with visualization, but dashboards and technology. And those are the few things that we do. At this point, we will take a few questions. There's a question I'm going to put right out on the table that's usually asked. And the first question that people always ask is, well, what are the visualization tools that you were using? If you didn't see the logo, we are a business partner with MicroStrategy. So the visualizations that we used in this webinar are from MicroStrategy.